everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. It seems like we're a little behind the curve here with the M12 spoilers.
Just a lot of spoilers happened right after we filmed last week, and we had plenty of stuff to talk about, mostly about me, and so...
That was the vast majority of our time, I'm not going to lie.
Time well spent.
But it's okay. We've whittled down the 140 so cards that we've seen so far.
It looks like they're doing a good job of... I mean, because most of these aren't... leaked spoilers. These are like they chose to release them via Duels of Planeswalkers.
I'd like to think that from here on out, for at least a little while, we're going to see a pretty
Which means that instead of the normal spoiler season where we get all the exciting cards first and then we get like the less exciting ones later, when they control it, we get all the commons and stuff first, and then most of the exciting cards come later, which is the best way to do it. So
yeah, I'm so used to being like, this is really splashy, this is really cool, and it's like, let's look at limited implications, and now we're kind of like, oh, there might be a mill theme, or like, you know, it's right. Red looks really powerful, those are the commons we've seen, and now we get to kind of go the reverse order.
We definitely have seen some really cool cards, but in terms of the there's a lot of rares and mythics we have not yet seen, but there are some cool ones to talk about.
I mean, let's jump right into the biggest elephant or Jace in the room, talking about the new Jace.
Memory Adept.
All right.
Well, he starts out with, what, 4 loyalty?
Yeah, and then might go up or down or not.
He plus ones to draw a card, or target player draws a card?
No, it's just straight up draw a card.
Okay, so you draw a card and then you mill either player, which obviously becomes more relevant if Innistrad is in fact a graveyard set, which is what it's rumored to be. At a -2, he mills target player for 10.
I got it at a 0.
Oh, it's 0?
Yeah.
Oh, that's even better. And then at -7, I think, is any number of players draw 20 cards.
Haha, so fun.
So he's pretty interesting. I think the turning point on whether he's going to be good is whether the mill one is good or not. And it's going to be at its best if in Innistrad milling yourself is profitable. Or if, you know, as other cards on the list predict, maybe milling yourself is profitable just by milling 10 or something.
So if it was just draw a card, you know, glimpse the unthinkable somebody, and then the kind of innocuous ultimate, do you think it would be good enough on its own?
As written in this format now, I'm like, well, no, this card is not where it needs to be. But there are a lot of things that can make it good, like flashback spells, cards like Vengevine, though of course they won't exist in the same standard environment. I think it's pretty close. It comes out with like a fair amount of loyalty, and it just zero or goes up. It does, you know, it's pretty hard to kill.
I mean, it doesn't exactly pass the Planeswalker test in the fact that, it can't protect itself. There's no interaction with the board.
Jace does not interact with the board, and that has traditionally come in kind of like a death knell for Planeswalkers. Like, you know, you look at like Liliana or Jace, and they tend not to be as powerful as, you know, something like Elspeth or other Jace or... like a Johnny Vengeance. The ones that can actually protect themselves tend to survive better because they're better by themselves.
It seems like this card is going to be under the most scrutiny out of any card in the set.
Well, of course, it's called a Jace.
Right. And again, the first one you mentioned comparing it to is really Liliana. I mean, they have the
same
casting
cost. That's what reminds
me
the most, yeah.
Like, the plus ability is kind of good in the control match one way or another. The middle ability may or may not be good depending on what it is. And then the last ability should hopefully win the game.
Yeah, but it's going to be hard to get there. 7, when you start at 4 and go up by a turn, is still... quite a few turns away, especially since, again, you're not protecting yourself, whereas, like, a Johnny Vengeance was locking down a guy or something.
So, at the moment, not a whole lot of impact for Standard, none of...
This is the card that can vary a lot based on what sort of graveyard shenanigans are around. If there's a legitimate mill deck, it's good. If there is enough incentive to mill yourself, it becomes good. Like, and both those things could very well happen.
I mean, the zeroing at every turn to do to somebody...
Yeah, that's a pretty fast clock, like... Especially if you've got other cards to help you out, and you know, presumably you will.
If you think of that as the kill condition in terms of Planeswalkers, I guess it's pretty fast, and again, it doesn't hurt itself.
Yeah, it comes out at 4 loyalty, so you can play it, mill them for 10. If they have like a 2-2 or 3-3 out, they hit it down to 1, you mill them for 10 again. Like, you know, that's pretty good already, especially if you've got another Jace waiting in the wings.
It still seems like it's really only good in like a control mirror where no one's really doing anything to the board.
Well, you can just it'll just like depend on what sort of decks become popular and, you know, how good your deck is at keeping creatures off the board. Again, it's like a legitimate win condition, so it's good when Planeswalkers get to do that.
It's just kind of awkward. It's like, today, right now, not a really good card. But hopefully, it's like, it's kind of one of those things where it's like, fingers crossed.
Well, it's just dependent on what else we see, which is most cards are. I mean, it's not like Primeval Titan by itself is a card, but with Valakut, it becomes a very, very good card. So, you know, that's another card that we'll see how it goes once Valakut rotates out.
All right.
What do we got next?
Enough talk about Jace. Ooh, Phantasmal Image, the new clone.
Yeah, this card definitely has potential. At two mana, you're really not paying a whole lot of mana. And yeah, it's clone, and anytime it becomes targeted, it dies. Cloning a Shroud guy is pretty cute, or a Hexproof guy is pretty cute. cloning a guy with an Enter the Battlefield ability is quite good as well, because then you're getting value no matter what. And even just cloning a guy for two mana is very cheap. And even if they kill it, I mean, they spent a card to kill your two mana card. That generally does not put you that far behind. If they go for the throat, your two mana card, I mean, that's not horrible, especially if you got some sort of value out of it by cloning a Titan or something like that.
But that's, to me, that's really the real question, is making clone half price going to be a high enough, like, advantage that, you know, we're talking about cloning six casting cost guys, paying four doesn't seem like it's, you know, too unreasonable to do if it's powerful enough. What is making it two? Are there aggressive enough cost? I mean, do you want to make Fauna Shamans? Do you want to make Mana Accelerant Birds?
I don't know exactly where it would fit in, but it's just a cheap, good card. And especially when you, like, can you imagine Sun Titan getting back the clone, cloning the Sun Titan, getting back something else? Like, that seems like a pretty sweet line of play.
Okay, all right, I'm sold there. That's pretty exciting. That's definitely the big difference between four and two there. Because kind of looking at it in a vacuum, it's like, well...
Well, it's also just cheap enough that, like, if you're playing, like, some sort of, like, blue-green, like, you know, aggressive-ish deck, and, you know, you can start cloning Vengevines or just paying two mana is just so cheap. And, like, you really aren't going to go too far wrong, especially, again, if there's guys with good come-to-play abilities that you could end up cloning.
So going like kind of a sort of side of that, we have the new blue Lord, like Lord of the Unreal.
Yeah, which is blue 2/2 and gives all your illusions +1 and hexproof. And yeah, obviously he's built to play with all the Phantasmal guys.
I don't feel like there's enough tools for like the aggressive blue beatdown deck, but it's very nice that that's something kind of new that we haven't really
Lord of the Unreal is a pretty nice name too. That was a pretty unreal draw. But
yeah, there'll definitely be a draft video somewhere in your near future where you hear Luis say that, I'm sure. One side of the board or the other.
Yeah, but I don't see the fact that the multiple lords don't stack, whereas like Lord of Atlantis or whatever do, is kind of annoying. Like, you know, two lords, they're not 3/3s, they're still both 2/2s because they're not illusions. So that makes it a bit of a harder sell to me. I don't know if there's enough illusions to make it really worth it.
It's still kind of a cool thing and very different. I mean, I also kind of like the kind of the mini flavor that like blue lords get to cost cheaper than like it's not like Goblin King costs three and Elvis Champion costs three and then Lord of Atlantis and this guy costs two. I think it's kind of cute
for no particular reason.
It's just kind of like that's cool. Moving on, we've got Visions of Beyond, a card you might be a fan of.
Yeah, I previewed this card in you know, the article I wrote. And I think, this is one of the cards that, like, for example, rewards you for Jacing, like, you know, milling 10 or whatever. Because at 1 mana for drawing 3, like, that's a card you can actually build a deck around. So even if it takes a little bit of work, it's still probably worth it.
Interesting.
Which means that it's not like a... by itself, it cycles, which is obviously more than fine, but... the fact that once you start going off, it chains into more and really gets your deck going. It means that if there's a mill deck, this is going to be a really big part of it. Because this is what keeps the gas tank full. You're able to keep casting mill cards, which don't do anything by themselves, because it enables Visions from Beyond. And it also like seems like it fits pretty well in the Hegion Crab Vengevine sort of deck.
So in current Type 2, I mean...
In current Type 2, like right now, right when M12 comes out, I mean, if people thought Dredgevine was a deck, this... certainly makes the deck better.
I mean, you've got Renegade Doppelganger, new Phantom Clone, you know, this kind of thing. Maybe that's enough fuel to kind of reinvigorate that engine.
Yeah, because the new Phantom Clone works well with Hedron Cab. It works well with Vengevine. Because, in either case, you're interested in doubling up on, like, some of those guys, and it's cheap enough, and it triggers Vengevine, you know, at a pretty cheap cost. So the deck likes having cheap guys. And I think that this Visions from Beyond work quite well in the deck.
Is it Dredge playable?
Oh, and like Legacy Dredge or Modern Dredge? I don't know. Maybe? If the Dredge deck doesn't want Brainstorm, I don't see how this is much better. Brainstorm does the same thing for you.
It's like you can't play Breakthrough in Modern. Maybe you could play this card?
Yeah. I still... It's like when you're winning, win.
Right. That was kind of my question. It's like 20 cards is...
Well, on the other hand, cycling one when you have a Dredger is not that bad. And... you're glad they have it. So, and the fact that once you've dredged a couple times, all of a sudden it dredges your whole deck. Yeah, maybe that is good enough. I mean, I'd be interested to see that. Hopefully with Modern as an actual format.
So, yeah, I mean, first looking at this card, it was like 20. Like, that's going to take a while.
Yeah, but... I mean, my first inclination was like, maybe this is good in a control deck. You can just, you know, wait. But 20 is enough that might not actually just really work. Like, it might just be unrealistic to hit 20, which means that this is left in the decks that actually work for it. But like I said before, it's worth working for.
Good to know. Good to know. And again, cycles, which means that it can never be like bad.
Yeah, it still costs you a deck space and, you know, time, so.
I guess. Moving on, we've got a pretty sweet reprint, a Goblin Grenade.
Yeah, I thought this card was sweet when I first saw it. I like the original art more, or one of the original arts, I guess, the spiky one or whatever. But Goblin Grenade seems like a pretty sweet card. If people have been trying to make Goblin decks work, you know, Kaloth Rebirth and stuff, Goblin Grenade definitely goes to the face for a lot of damage.
Finally, those Goblin Arsonists do something.
Yeah, boom. I think it's fun to have this around. I suspect that I will die to it at some point, because it does seem like a very playable constructed card. And I just think it's a funny card to have around. I definitely like it.
Again, it's always like, ooh, is Goblins going to be an archetype in Limited? You know, is the kind of Goblin Grenade-esque red decks going to be something to kind of keep other decks honest in the future Type 2 formats? Five is, you know, a number not to be messed with. That's a lot of damage.
Yeah, I assume it's uncommon?
Yes, it's uncommon for Limited purposes.
Yeah, that's what it was. If it was common in Limited, it'd probably be a little oppressive, like, you know, draft a 3 Goblin Grenade deck or whatever. But even at uncommon, yeah, it's a card worth considering. If you've got 5 or 6 Goblins in your deck, it might be playable. So,
similar to, like, Feast and Blood for Zendikar Limited, maybe?
Yeah, it's close.
Grim Lavamancer's back.
Yeah, just exciting to note, not because I'll be using it, but because I'll be losing to it, because it's just an insanely powerful card. You know, red decks, I'm sure, will be happy to have it. I've already started testing against it, so.
Again, there's a lot of people that's talking about that short window where you have M10, M11.
Bolt and Grim Lavamancer.
And the next card on our list being Incinerate, kind of replacing Bolt in the set. You know,
for a while, you can play them all, and just red seems like it'd be quite good at that point.
Now, 2 years ago, we were extremely excited to get Bolt. We thought it was going to be great. I mean, decks like the white, blue, red deck that you've played for a while in Standard was kind of a control
bolt.
Deck, Splashing Bolt. How different do you think Incinerate
is? Not Bolt. Like, I can't see a control deck Splashing Bolt or Incinerate, because 2 mana is like, well, twice as much as 1 mana. It's enough more that you go from having a super efficient answer to just like on par answer, and you can just do better than that. At that point, there's no reason to touch another color. But when it was Bolt, it was. So the off-color decks won't splash it as often, but Bolt's a very good card. Incinerate's still, for the red deck, it's obviously worse, but not like insanely worse. It's still good to use it. So
you're far more likely to see Go for the Throats in people's control decks than you are to see Incinerate.
Right, if you're going to take the trouble of splashing a color, you might as well splash a color that, you know, gets it done for 2 mana, as opposed to just doing 3 damage for 2 mana. So,
all right. A little bit of a downgrade, but we got some other stuff. If the poor man's Figure Destiny up next, Skin Shifter.
Skin Shifter.
Or the rich man's Primal Clay. It's kind of also high. This card was rare forever.
Let's just say, really this bad. Card is not morphing. Anyone who says that just has no idea what they're talking about.
I never thought that at any point.
It's a sweet card, though. I mean, it's definitely better than Primal Clay. And I don't know how. I mean, the fact that you have to pay a mana every turn, like, this is not what a beatdown deck really wants to be doing. Because Figure Destiny, you pay your mana and you forget about it. Skin Changer. Yeah, you have to pay mana every turn if you really want to get the full value. And sadly, you can lose it once a turn, so you can't, like, fly over as a 2-2, then turn into a Rhino and punch them.
That would be very good, obviously. Yeah.
At once a turn, I think.
I mean, it doesn't trigger in the upkeep, which is kind of nice, which is what I kind of thought when I was thinking about it at
first. Oh, yeah, you don't have to. You can make the choice at any point.
Right, which seems like it has a little bit more upside there. Again, it's really hard to consider, like, oh, well, you know, my green aggressive decks will definitely be able to make this guy a 4-4 on turn 3, and then maybe a 4-4 on turn something, or in the future, like, and how is that good?
Spending a mana a turn is just such a big cost. So, it's a cool card. It's definitely worth mentioning. I don't, however, think it's going to be like that great. I think the mana every turn is really what kills it.
To me, it's like thumb up design-wise. Like,
it's an awesome design. It's definitely a skin changer. Like, but yeah, if what you said, if it just triggered during the upkeep, it would be less tricky, but I think it'd be more playable. As is, paying a mana every turn is just not something a well-constructed deck is going to really want to do.
That's the end of the list. That was everything we had marked.
Well, there's a number of sweet cards there, and like Jace and Visions from Beyond are definitely cards which I'm excited to see, because these are the kind of cards that you need more cards to really fully figure out how good they are, whereas cards like Incinerate and Grim Lavamancer, we know how good those cards are, we know how good they're going to be, and the answer are very good.
Now, the quick off your head kind of topic, do you know what pro level or high level events you're going to be playing with this core set for, like sealed deck or anything?
No, I know Nationals is going to have draft of M12, and I assume there's going to be like a GP or something afterwards. I guess I haven't actually looked at the schedule yet, because, you know, when it comes to comes. But
you know, that's one of the big questions with the modern kind of core set theme. Every year we get a new set. Is, you know, how do you make it different but also competitive playable? Again,
I was super happy with M11 in that vein. I mean, you were saying like they have to balance all these things. And I mean, do you like how what they did with M11?
I liked it a lot. I think it was an upgrade on M10, but the still it's like it was. To me, like the hardest thing to balance is it's supposed to be the set for new players, but at the same time, people like you have to play it at least a couple times a year at a pro level event.
Yeah.
You have to keep it different at the same time. Like you lose one old mechanic, you bring in a new mechanic. Like you lost Scry, bring in Bloodthirst. Is that better for limited? Maybe. Is it going to be different enough and, you know, interesting enough? Yes, probably. Like you've got the cards like the Vampire's Touch or whatever, and the unblockable can't block guys.
Yeah, like the one mana guy. Or
enable it, and like to me, it's like. From this point forward, there's a really hard high bar that you have to set, that you have to meet for all these things, but at the same time, keep it different enough that every year you don't go into it being like, oh, this is just M10 again, and I don't care. Like, you know, I'm going to play it and whatever. And so far, it seems like they've definitely done that.
Yeah, and part of the reason the bar is so high is they've done such a good job on M11 and M10. Like, M11 was just actually one of the better limited formats I've played, like, in general, not even just core set. Like, I just legitimately enjoyed the format. I think Scry is probably going to be a mechanic I like more than Bloodthirst, but Bloodthirst is still an interesting limited mechanic in that it forces you to really, really keep in mind what their attacks are trying to accomplish, when they want to throw away guys, when they're bluffing. Like, it makes bluffs a lot better because now with Bloodthirst, your natural condition is to block, which means that if you want them to block, you're in a lot better shape. Like, if you've got tricks you want them to walk into, they're a lot more likely to walk into them.
See, it's so great because it goes up and down the ladder, too. Like, that's a competitive, you know, aspect of it. And on the other side, teaching players to attack before they cast spells is a very simple thing to do.
Yeah, it very much does that. And in terms of, like, flavor, like, you know, cards like Skin Changer are just, like, these are the evocative cards that you want in a core set, and they've done a great job with them so far. Like, having cards that top-down design, you know, that you look at the card and you can just instantly get what the card's trying to do, and it just encapsulates it perfectly. So yeah, I mean, core sets are certainly one of their hardest to design sets because it has to appeal to all these demographics and has to fulfill all these requirements, and they've done a great job so far. And hopefully M11 continues, though. Grim Lovemancer, I'm a little frightened. Things are looking grim.
It'll be fine. Fine.
We'll see. So next week, we'll hopefully have some more sweet cards to talk about.
Yeah, I mean, who knows? At that point, it might be all over. It might have the whole thing.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Thanks for watching.
Boom.
One more?
I think that's it.
One more?
Definitely. Commander cards, right? Everyone wants to know about commander cards.
Let's talk about all the playable commander cards. Okay, we did that.